With me is Kevin Ault. He is a doctor here who's an OBGYN and member of the CDC Advisory Committee on Immunization. Today was a historic vote, just less than an hour ago, as committee members decided the best way to allocate the first COVID-19 vaccine to gain FDA emergency use authorization. Dr. Ault, you've been attending the committee for 15 years. That's approximately a very long time. How has this process differed, and what does today's vote mean?
Well, we are specifically looking at the time frame where there's going to be a limited number of doses. We were talking about the first 20 to 40 million doses, and we were making decisions about who should get those doses. And what we decided was we were calling it phase one. So phase 1A is healthcare workers and residents in long-term care facilities are really going to be the first target in this first month or two when we have vaccine available.
So one of your colleagues today, esteemed colleagues today, likened the decisions and vetting around this choice to the votes King Solomon had when he had to make an impossible choice. What were some of the considerations you had to make during this?
I think the choice is difficult because we don't have the data from the phase three trials. So there are these trials that are ongoing right now. KU is participating in several of them. That have 30 and 40,000 people in them. And next week, actually, the Food and Drug Administration is going to have a hearing to talk about the data from these trials, and then we'll have another meeting for our group after that. So I think the particularly challenging part of today's vote, and this came out in the discussion, was the residents of long-term care facilities. I'm not sure how many people in that group are enrolled in these trials. And of course, we want to know what the safety and efficacy is in that particular population since we made this vote today.
Yeah, and it's got to be hard because here you are not knowing all the results of the vaccine, not knowing fully what's going on and what the side effects are, but being asked to prioritize patients.
We did a somewhat similar process in 2009. I was actually representing the OBGYN doctors at that time, and we talked about who should get the H1N1 influenza vaccine. I think we did it that summer, if my memory serves me correctly. So, but yeah, we've done these exercises before when there was going to be a scarcity of vaccine and a pandemic going on.
Okay. Well, we know the interest among media has been high, and we set aside a few minutes early here to allow reporters to ask questions. Please say your name, reporters, and who you're with. Let's see if there's any reporter questions. Okay, not hearing many. I have a couple for you. No shocker there. So first, Dr. Ault, tell us a little bit your background. How did you end up on an FDA advisory committee like this, which is so, or a CDC advisory committee, which is so important?
When I was a young doctor, actually 25 years ago last month, I was just thinking about this. There were the beginning of the clinical trials for the human papillomavirus vaccine, and I have been in this studio before talking about human papillomavirus vaccine, and as a gynecologist, you know, I was very interested in the time about cervical cancer prevention. So that's how I got involved with the CDC. Also in 2009, you know, we appreciated that respiratory disease was more serious in pregnant women. We'd known that about influenza for decades and decades, more than a century. And so I was also involved in that pandemic 11 years ago.
And your background is both in OBGYN and infectious disease. Talk to us a little bit about that.
So straight out of my residency at Ohio State, I came here to work with Dr. Sebastian Farrow, who was the chairman of obstetrics gynecology at the time, and got a very good education with him about infectious disease and have continued it into now.
So you mentioned that the wave 1A would be healthcare workers. Was that and nursing home patients?
Yes, and actually, I have a question for you and people like you. You know, there we talk about macro planning and micro planning quite a bit. And so macro planning was that we're going to have healthcare workers in this group. Micro planning, I think, is where you get involved because you're going to have to decide, you know, which order to do things in. And there will be more granular detail in the next few weeks. But, you know, which physicians, which healthcare workers, which providers get the vaccine first at your facility. I don't know that I have any great insights into that, and it's probably going to vary from facility to facility, but that was one of the groups the reason long-term residents of long-term care facilities came to the front is the tremendous mortality in that group. It's, I think we said today, about 100,000 deaths in that group in the United States, very vulnerable population. Vaccinating both the residents and the people who take care of those vulnerable patients was one of the groups in the 1A group.
Yeah, I think my self-interest would be, we need to keep people healthy who are going to be working with the most critically ill patients from that. And what we've learned is that our ICU staffing and hospital staffing is challenged by COVID because, as at least at our hospital today, there's 160 patients with COVID and about not quite half of those folks are in an ICU bed. So we've had to have a net increase in those beds. We got to keep those staff healthy. So to me, that's the first thing. Without knowing how many doses we have, it gets a little hard after that. But I would say the more that can be done with the drugs to keep the patients who would otherwise be coming to us who are critically ill, that will take a lot of the pressure off because otherwise people who have heart attacks and strokes can't get care. So, I mean, that's how I would view it. So to me, that nursing home piece is critically important because that's a source of patients who come right to the ICU so frequently because they're so sick.
We have seven reporters on the line. Okay, so let's see, and then we'll continue.
Let's jump. You bet. Let's go. Reporter.
They're just lurking. I don't think we're having a technical problem. I will tell you that we had one question from a reporter that wanted to know if there's going to be more votes that will be taken on the vaccine as it goes through different phases and stages. And could you explain?
Yes, absolutely. Today was interim guidance was in the title of the resolution that we voted on. So we don't have a product yet that has an emergency use authorization. So yes, we're going to have to go back and vote on that specifically. I think next Thursday is the 10th is when the FDA hearing is, the Food and Drug Administration, and sometime in the week after that, it'll be in the news. And then the second version of the vaccine that's applied for an EUA is the week after that. So between now and the winter holidays, the end of the month of December, there'll be quite a bit of this voting and more news about the two vaccines that have applied for EUA.
Dr. Ault, do you have any sense of when those vaccines might actually be? Let's say they're it's approved. What, give us a sense of what you think your timeline would be or the timeline would be for when vaccines would show up at a hospital.
Well, there's a 3 or 4 day process after the vote at the FDA, and then there's a day or two for us to vote. So in theory, within a week, they could be shipped. The one of the challenges of these first two vaccines is they have extreme handling specifications as far as cold chain.
Well, especially again, Pfizer. I know that was minus 84 or whatever, very cold temperature that's
so like. That's going to be very challenging for you. I keep referring to you as a physician executive. So, but for all the people who are involved in planning for this vaccine, that's going to be a huge challenge. I think the other challenge, and you know, we kind of touched on this a little bit before, is there are about 20 million people in that group of healthcare workers. It's not just physicians. It's pretty much everybody, paid and unpaid, who's at a hospital, that works at a hospital, and they do all the critical things that you mentioned previously. That's a huge group of people, and everybody needs two doses. So that's 40 million doses for that group of people. And then 3 million people, I think, is the correct number of nursing home residents, depending on how you count it. So 6 million there. So for the first month or two, again, predicting the future in this environment is very, very dicey. But for the first few weeks of the rollout, those are going to be the emphasized groups, and that's what we voted on today.
Yeah, and I'm going to bet you had a virtual meeting, not an in-person meeting.
We had a virtual meeting.
So there you go. So.
Stephanie wants to know, what about the care workers that take care of the mentally impaired?
So the definition of healthcare worker is incredibly broad. That's how you get up to 21 or 20 million. And so they would certainly be part of that group. So anybody that does patient contact, paid or unpaid, even is in the definition. So so that would definitely be a group according to the...
And correct me, but I think what happens is that now that the guidelines are being suggested by the CDC, the drugs are shipped and then each state makes some determination about how they define each of those categories. And then it's up to the local environment to further that definition.
Right. And not everybody might have somebody like that in their community. So it makes some sense to have some local input. Again, that's the microplanning.
So yes, it is.
Microplanning and microplanning.
And just so folks are aware, that's what happened just recently with these new monoclonal antibodies. There was a plan for it by the government. It went to the state. The state had a plan. Then we got shipped individual doses, and they just came. They showed up on our doorstep. We had a plan for how that was going to get distributed. And not every plan is the same. So the way we do it may be different than the way another hospital does it, based upon their own unique needs in that area. And I think the vaccinations are probably going to look a lot like that.
And traditionally, the role of this committee is to provide clinical guidance. And so that's what we're trying to do today.
There is a follow-up question to the clinical guidance.
Okay.
In the discussions that you were having, were doctors and experts in alignment, or was there convincing that had to be done? How does that discussion work?
This is the sixth or eighth meeting we've had on this topic. There are 14 members of the committee. There are pediatricians. There's at least one OBGYN, as mentioned previously, adult medicine doctors, family doctors. There's also probably 50 representatives on the committee that represent different specialty groups. So yeah, we've been meeting for quite a while, and we've been talking about what the priority groups should be since July, I think, was our first of these series of meetings. You can go back and look at the meetings on YouTube and hear the whole discussion. This is a transparent process. But yeah, there was consensus, but there was hours and hours and hours of meetings and discussion before we got to the few hours this afternoon.
Caprell asks, I've been hoping that long-term care facilities would include correctional facilities and their staff.
That's a big question. Let's talk about that. Both the correction facility, both the staff and the inmates. Because I know there was a question, do inmates going to get a vaccination?
That came up today, and somebody in the public comment period actually commented on that. So, and that has been commented on before. Certainly the people who work at the hospitals in those facilities or in healthcare at those facilities would be in the healthcare group, but then there would be essential workers after we get through this group of healthcare workers that are in line. So eventually, yes, the people who provide care and will get the vaccine. The inmates probably, I'm guessing, will fall under, you know, do they have underlying conditions? How old are they? That type of thing. So more like the general population. However, one thing I always say is that whatever I say today could be wrong tomorrow when we're talking about COVID. So some of those kind of details are yet to be worked out. So.
We have another question. Mark wants to know, what about those that are caring for elderly parents at home? They're a high-risk category, and there is also a question about how will the vaccine be rolled out in rural areas?
So I think that question about an elderly parent is a hard one, because just about anybody or a lot of people may try to claim that. I think it's not going to be that easy, because I suspect it's going to be more rolled out upon the parent's going to get a dose at a certain time, and then the kids will be classified, the people who are taking care of that parent will be classified based upon their own medical history, not the parents.
Based on what I know today, I think you're right.
And so that would be that there's precedent for that in lots of other areas around how we take care of the elderly. And what was the follow-up to that, Jill?
The follow-up question was just, what is going to be the access to rural areas?
I'm not sure
today's. You just dealt with allocation.
Right. It goes back to the point that was made earlier, I think, by both of us, where the cold chain requirements, they're very rigorous for these first two candidate vaccines that are awaiting the EUA authorization. And so it depends on if they have a minus 80. I mean, that's one of the challenges.
What we know is that a lot of healthcare facilities actually do have some cold storage freezers, especially if you have inpatients, and especially if you have to store other drugs. This won't be the only drug that has to be stored at a cold temperature. So many hospitals will have that. Now, you have to have the capacity in the freezer. You have to have the space for it. You have to have certain ways that that freezer can maintain that temperature. So there are real-time issues that you have to explore on the ground. There are plenty of cold storage freezers in Kansas and in Missouri. I can tell you that will be able to take care of the Pfizer drug, especially because the Moderna one, though it has to be cold, is not the special super cold storage freezer that the Moderna one is not. Pfizer has to be super cold storage. So once it gets rewarmed and it's given, then it's put in a refrigerator, and I think it is 12 hours stable in a refrigerator, if I remember right. Do you know that? I think it's 12 hours.
I do not know that, but again, that's the kind of guidance that will get played out over the next few weeks that people have been thinking about, since.
Yeah. So we've got a lot of places have plans. Kansas has already selected the storage places. I think we've already got a plan for how the drug's going to get distributed or the vaccine will get distributed. distributed. So I think that planning is in pretty advanced stages. And I'm concerned about it because it's logistically difficult, but I think there is a plan for how to get it done. So I think we're going to be okay on that part of it. I think the big question is going to be just how many doses each state really gets, and that we just don't know yet.
And we have a question. Did the committee have access to or ask questions about are we rushing on the vaccine, about safety and efficacy? Did you get to ask those kind of questions or see the data?
Our process is not rushed because we go through the same process for every vaccine. So as far as looking at the initial clinical trials, looking at the safety, looking at, you know, who might get the vaccine, how it would benefit society. We were talking about maximizing benefits and minimizing risk, as well as solving some health equity issues, especially about this particular vaccine or this particular disease and vaccine. So I guess I don't feel like our process was rushed, but because so many man hours have been put into it, you know, to before this point, so and will continue to be put in. So, you know, we will have data, and that will be publicly available next week for the first candidate vaccine, and then the week after that for the second one. So it's all transparent. It's all there. So everybody's going to have access to that data eventually.
I think we're all just incredibly anxious to see all that information. And those of us who in the healthcare field and have been in this kind of work for a long time, that data will mean everything to us about how we address it. So.
And to clarify, the process you went through for this vaccine continues for, as others receive the emergency use?
Absolutely. There was quite a bit of discussion about how to follow up on the safety with this vaccine. And it's similar to what we do for all vaccines. I think the only wrinkle that I heard was some cell phone programs. If you get the vaccine, you'll be able to send, you know, any adverse events you have, and especially the healthcare workers, we want them to sign up for that. So we have real-time monitoring of vaccine side effects and adverse events. So yeah, there's already a robust system in place to look for safety signals, plus it's going to be enhanced.
And that is so important because we have to remember that this drug has an early use authorization. It's not FDA approved. That's a different statement. And in fact, I think that we won't be requiring it of our employees here at KU because it's not an FDA approved drug. We authorize the early use of it because we're in a pandemic and we need some type of new tools to try and help combat that. And so while we are confident or hopefully confident that the vaccines are going to be both effective and safe, we don't have all the data yet. I think that's a great idea that people can submit right off their cell phones what side effects they're having. So you're not relying on physicians to fill out those long, laborious forms that we get every time you put a patient on a drug. And you stop and you do it on your phone. That'll be great. You'll actually get
if they're so long and laborious, you just can do it on your phone. So, yeah.
Right.
So.
Okay. One more call for any reporters that might be on the line that are able to ask a question now. We have 2 minutes.
I'm glad the safety part came up because that was quite a bit of the discussion this meeting and the meeting before.
And we just don't know about it, right? We just haven't seen enough of the data. And Pfizer and Moderna have been great. They've been telling us about it. But they really don't tell us about all the side effects, which is kind of what they do right now. But it's good that the FDA and the CDC are going to be looking at those kind of pieces of information to help determine about how to distribute it.
One final question. School nurses considered?
Yes, that would be. It's a very liberal, inclusive definition of healthcare workers. So yes.
And so I can tell you at KU, the way we plan to look at this, it's going to depend a little bit on how much drug we have, our vaccines we have, but the first group will be the folks who are directly involved with COVID patients. Then depending on how much we have thereafter, and that means nursing, dietary, house cleaning, the physicians, the whoever. If you're involved with a COVID patient, that you're first, that's 1A. And then after that, the rest of the healthcare workforce will start getting, because we can all be around it. The first group we have to get vaccinated, those folks who are at the bedside, because we think they have the highest risk of folks.
And again, that's the micro planning.
Yeah.
Individual places are going to have to make those decisions.
And we'd love to have enough doses we can give it to everybody. All right. I want to say thank you.
Sure.
First of all, thank you, Dr. Ault, for your service to your country and to your community and to KU, the great work that you do every day and with your patients. We're hoping to have you on our morning media update in the very near future. We'll bring you back next week, we're hoping. I know you got to go do call.
I have
to go take care of patients tonight.
Practice medicine, yes.
Folks out there listening, please join us for the next morning update. We're back tomorrow. And then remember, next week, we're going to be talking the entire week about vaccination because we think that's really important. We're going to keep a close close watch on the viral spread across Kansas and Missouri. We'll update you on the mitigation efforts to free up beds tomorrow, and we'll be with you then, and we'll be with you always. Thank you so much. We'll see you soon.